Morning, family. You know why I call you family? Because we're all related, right? We have one father, so you're my family. But I ain't gonna lend you no money. So if everybody has a seat, so we can start. We just want to start with a morning prayer. Get in. So let's pray. Father, we're just so grateful to be gathered together, Lord, to worship you, to give you reverence, Father. We ask, Lord, that you just open our hearts and our minds, loose our tongues so we can praise you, give you all the glory, Lord. We bow down before you today, heart and soul, Lord. We come here expecting to receive something from you, Lord. Because we know you'll never let us down, Lord. Your promises are true, and you are forever, Lord. So you never lie. You're not a man that you should lie. So when you say you'll be with us and you'll strengthen us, comfort us, we stand on your promises today, Lord. I ask, Father, that you be with this congregation today. Bless them. Bless those who came out on this first chilly day and came out to worship you. I pray for those who couldn't come for whatever reason they couldn't come. And I just want to say, to you be the glory, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. And I believe that we have the reading, the scripture reading, that will be Naphtali.
Could we all stand, please? Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. When tempted, no one should say, "God is tempting me," for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. Then, after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chooses to give birth through the world, that we might be a kind of first fruits. All he created.
Amen. Good morning. Ooh.
May we all stand and prepare to worship our Lord.
Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me.
There you go. Okay, it's time for the congregational prayer. Before we go into that, you know, there's a lot happening in the world. I knew, you know, like with Israel, and everybody knows that Israel is at war now, right? And the Bible commands us to pray for the peace of Israel. And Israel is a focal point in the Bible and throughout history. And a lot of things happen with Israel that affect the world. So we have to keep that in mind because, you know, we just finished the book of Revelations and the flashpoint of all things is going to be Israel. So let's keep Israel in prayer, okay? And now we're going to pray for those that are sick, those that are in need. Okay, let's pray. Father, we just thank you for another day of life, a day that wasn't promised to anyone. It's a gift from you, Father. Help us to enjoy it as a gift, to savor the moment. Father, we just lift up those today who could not make it for whatever reason it may be, Lord. If they're sick, if they're not feeling well, I pray, Father, that you look down upon them and minister to them through the internet. I pray for those that have financial needs, Lord, that you open doors of opportunity. But more importantly, Lord, I pray for those who are having spiritual battles, because the battle is yours, Father. Help us to step back and let you do what you do best, Lord, win. Father, we thank you, Lord, because we are more than conquerors. We're victors in Christ. And I pray for this congregation, Lord, for all our needs, our wants, our necessities, Lord. I know you'll meet all our needs, maybe not all our wants, Lord, but You give us more. Our cup runneth over, for sure. I ask, Lord, that you bless the pastor today, Lord. Anoint him. Anoint the words that he's about to speak. Open our hearts to these words, Lord. Be glorified in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Man, it's good being here, isn't it? Praise God for that. Amen. Who's cold? Ronnie's cold. I'm happy you're here, though. Praise God. In case you did not know, tomorrow is Amanda's birthday. She's possibly the most extroverted person I know. And Tony's thinking, thou shalt not lie, right? when we got married, I think you were 20. That's why I say I raised her. You know. I was 26. Who just said some blasphemy? Somebody was blaspheming here. Was that you? What did you say? What did you say? It is the other way around. we've been married 16 years. So that means you will be 37. She'll be 37, and and you might think, man, you're so young, and some of you and my kids think, man, you're so old. I think we need to sing happy birthday. What do you say? Yes. So would you, how can we embarrass her the most? Huh? Oh, everyone stand up, look at her, and let's sing happy birthday. Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Amanda. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Thank you. This is probably the most embarrassed you've been at church for a long time, right? Tony, it will feel weird for me to pray. Would you pray for my wife? And there is a... I'll just give you the phone, the microphone.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for Amanda, Lord. We thank you for the blessing she is to all of us. We ask, Lord, that you bless her. Bless her in every way possible. As a wife, as a mother, as a hospital, as a nurse. I pray, Father, that you use her for your glory, Lord, and be glorified in all that she does. I pray, Father, that you bless her as she goes in and as she comes out. I pray that you just continue to give her wisdom, guidance, and understanding. And once again, we just thank you for another year of life for her, for this introverted person. In Jesus' name. Right.
And now you're thinking, I know, you'll get home. I know where you sleep. Oh, man. Anybody else's birthday today or tomorrow or this week? You don't want me to embarrass you. Is that what it is? We'll leave it at that then. In the book of Exodus chapter 12, we find a very powerful story, and it has to do with the people of Israel leaving Egypt, going into the promised land. The context of chapter 12 is that there were the plagues that led to the Pharaoh allowing the Israelites to leave the promised land. The Israelites were slaves in Egypt, and slavery was free labor in the case of the Jews in Israel. In Egypt. So it is very difficult to let go of free labor. How do you just let that go? It's hard. And some people estimate that there were over 1 million Jews or Israelites in Egypt as slaves. Some go as far as to say about 2 million of them. So imagine 2 million people, and let's say about 1/3 of them are like hardworking people, young men who can work really hard, or whatever. Imagine then just letting that go. That's not easy to do. That's why the plagues were there. One of the reasons why the plagues were there was to show that there is a God, that the Lord, the God of Israel, is stronger than any other God there is. And it was a way of letting the Pharaoh know that it is not up to him to let the Israelites go. It is God's plan, and God was at work in that. And so the plagues happened, and then we, in chapter 12, faced the last of those plagues, which was the death of the firstborn. Imagine having your first child who you know is going to die. This is a very difficult thing to deal with. In the case of the Pharaoh, that implied the next one in line to be the king of Egypt. If his firstborn died, there would be no one to take his place. And so it was the one that touched him the most. That plague was packed with symbolism. And what was going to happen in the death of the firstborn was something so powerful it had to be remembered forever. And that's why the Passover was instituted, to commemorate what the Lord was about to do. In chapter 12 of Exodus, we find that the Passover involved an animal, a lamb, baby lamb, a lamb, perfect, no imperfection in the lamb. And it was to be killed. It was to be eaten in a certain way. The blood of the lamb was to be put in the door, what do you call it? Doorpost. And the Bible tells us that the angel of death was going to pass and by. There, that's why it's called Passover. The angel of death was going to pass by, and when seeing the blood, the firstborn would be saved. The symbolism of Passover is actually Jesus. In the book of John, chapter 1, John sees Jesus and says, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." In the book of Revelation, Jesus is presented as the victorious lamb that was slain. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 6, the Bible tells us that we have been purchased, and the price was the blood of Jesus. And this is what Passover is about. It was about celebrating and bringing to mind there was going to be a lamb that came from God that was going to save not just the firstborn, but everyone by his blood. He is the firstborn in the sense that he is the only begotten Son of God. And it is through the blood of Jesus that our sins have found forgiveness. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible tells us there is no remission for sins. Jesus shed his blood to forgive our sins. And this is why we celebrate communion, to remember what Jesus did for us. Death, the angel of death, was going to come by. If the blood of the Lamb was on the doorpost, life will remain. The blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus, has covered us. If we have given our all to Him, and if He's our Lord, our sins have been forgiven and death has no power over us. Amen? Amen? Isn't this something worthy of remembrance? It goes deeper. It's worthy of celebrating. And that's what we are going to do right now. If you have been baptized by immersion, we invite you to grab one of these cups that is in front of your pew. It has a little film that covers the bread. Underneath, you find the grape juice, the fruit of the vine. And symbolically now, we're going to eat Jesus' flesh, drink His blood, in remembrance of the forgiveness and salvation that His death made possible for all of us. Before we partake of the elements, I'm going to read the book of Matthew chapter 26. This is a celebration of Passover with a new twist, the Christian twist. This is the celebration of Jesus' death. Not the common lamb that they ate, but the Lamb of God. And symbolically, we eat His flesh. This, in Matthew 26, is the celebration of our new life in God. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says my appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus directed them and prepared the Passover. Verse 26. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my blood." Then He took a cup, and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Father, thank you for Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. The blood of Jesus, one that cleanses us from our sins. Thank you for His blood. And thank you for the new life that we have in you. I know we sin against you with our thoughts, with our words, with the intentions of our hearts, with our actions. But I thank you because there is forgiveness through the blood of Jesus, the Lamb of God. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may partake. Amen. I want to invite my brothers who are responsible to help us collect the offering to please come forward. Offerings is not about giving money. It's not about giving money to God or the church or anything like that. It's about worship. When you research the concept of offering, you would understand that it has to do with a grateful heart that wants to express gratitude. And this is what offering is about. It's about us recognizing that every good and perfect gift comes from God. That everything that we have, He has given it to us. And that the only thing we're doing is expressing gratitude for His kindness, and for his goodness. This is an act of worship. And the beautiful thing is that as we give generously, God blesses us. Amen. Yes, in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 9, giving instructions about offerings, the Apostle Paul tells us, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. I praise God because we are blessed. Amen. And I praise God for the opportunity to express our gratitude and worship Him through the offerings. Father, thank you. I praise you because truly we came to this world with nothing. And this is the case of everyone here and everyone, period. And yet we have so much, and all of it came from you. Receive these offerings as an expression of gratitude to a grateful, from a grateful heart. In Jesus' name, amen. God is good. Amen. All the time? Amen. That was weird. Let's do it again. God is good. All the time. Amen. Ladies, please.
Good morning, church. If we can all please stand. And I just want to share that yesterday was a very good blessing from God. I'm very grateful that the ladies were able to get together yesterday in Christ and just reflect and renew ourselves. And today I want to invite you as well, you know, whatever you're carrying on your back or whatever heavy is in your heart and your mind, give it to God. Give it completely to God and renew yourself in Him. And surrender yourself to the Lord. So if we can all please sing and worship to our God.
I will enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, God, He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad, He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. Enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His
has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Amen. He has made us glad.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation, Jesus, for our sake you died.
Praise God.
All glory be to God. All it takes is to believe in Christ. He's calling you today. His presence is here.
There is no fear, 'cause I believe. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I have a hope found in your name. I have a strength found in your grace. Your faithfulness, my fortress. All things are possible in you. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your words unstoppable. All things are possible in you.
Thank you. I don't know if you have, but if you haven't, would you tell the person that is in front, behind, or next to you, I love you in Christ? Love is to be expressed, right? You need to express love. We can go back and forth for half an hour if you want, right? Oh, man. It reminds me like kids when they are dating. I love you more. No, I love you more. No, I love you. No. Who's done that? Yeah, I think Ronnie has. And Louis too. By the way, I want to thank the ladies who got involved in putting together the event yesterday. It sounds like everyone had a lot of fun, so thank you for doing that. We finalized the Minecraft competition. I knew of about 20 children working on something, but for some reason or another, they stopped. Except there was a little girl who did it, and she submitted it. Would you be open to look at the creation? So the idea was to create a replica of this church building. Who plays Minecraft here, by the way? You guys embarrassed to say? Yeah. Okay. All right. It's nothing wrong with playing Minecraft. But anyway, we do have one. Can we play it, Victor? Yeah. Okay. So this is, the competition was about creating a replica of this building. And inside the building, at least three different rooms outside of the sanctuary. So this particular creation, I'm assuming you will be able to tell what part of the church it is at. And you can judge if it looks good or not. Does it? If it looks like our church or not, specifically. Bless you. One moment, please. All right. One more moment. By the way, as he's doing that, let's go to, there should be a Bible in front of your pew if you didn't bring one. And if you did bring it, it will be in the will be in the book of Nehemiah today. Nehemiah chapter 2. We're going to be covering verses 9 through 20. So today we'll finish chapter 2 of the book of Nehemiah. Beautiful book. I hope and encourage you to slowly go through chapter 1 and then go to chapter 2 slowly and soak in everything that the Lord has for you in such a beautiful book. By the way, the book of Nehemiah is known for its for being a good resource for leadership. Almost every Christian leadership book talks about Nehemiah. What is amazing to me is the position that Nehemiah had in the Persian government and the abilities that he had. In relation to his position, we were told in chapter 1 that he was the cupbearer of the king. He was the one who had a very desirable job. Maybe you'd like to be a cupbearer. Would you like that? No? Why not? Well, they had to try the food before the king tried it. And so, you know, a lot of people wanted to destroy the king so that they can take that place. And so the king trusted basically no one that surrounded him. There were children who tried to kill the kings or the kings to take their place. They were good to go. Yeah, and so they would try, somebody will try, they will have a specific person that will try the food and drinks that they will eat before they did to make sure it was safe to eat. And that was Nehemiah's job, to try the food before the king ate it. Now, that was his job. So he had access to the king, but what potential did he have? He had the potential of being an amazing governor. And that's what we see in the book of Nehemiah. Okay, we're ready for the videos. Let's see if this little girl's creation on Minecraft. There you go. You see the nursery, the windows? Is that the resource room? My office. The sound booth, foyer, nursery, you see the crib, the windows to the to see from back there down to the service. Wow. That's the classroom. That's the classroom. And that's the basement. And this is the exit door. The beach comes later. And that's the garden, right? You see the garden? With the prayer section there? What do you guys think? Actually, the one who did it was me. Man, you have a lot of faith on me, huh? Actually, Amanda did it. That was Amanda, so... All right. It was good, wasn't it? Yeah, it's kind of cool, kind of cool. If you wonder what in the world have they been talking for all this time about, well, that's what Minecraft does. It allows you to create or build things. So if you think that you could do a better job, maybe next year. Prove it. Next year, prove it. And do it and submit it, right? All right. Once again, Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 9 through 20. As we read this book, we see that there is a man who follows a specific sequence. Number one, he hears and sees. And seeing is very important. But he doesn't only see with his human eyes. He's capable of seeing with the eyes of faith. He can visualize what eventually becomes a reality. So he sees with his eyes, and he sees, in a sense, with his mind, but then he accesses faith to execute what he has previously visualized. Visualizing is very important. It's not just the ability of seeing carefully things. Yesterday, I was watching a video on a British man who has, I think he has... I forgot this condition. It's very common. He has limitations. The word will come to my mind. But he has the ability to remember anything he sees to crazy details. And he can be on top of a big building and see the whole city. And he will remember the whole city. And he will just get like a massive piece of paper, or I think it's paper, maybe it's a canvas, but it's humongous. And with a pen, he can actually replicate the entire city to the T because he has a perfect memory. He can see with his eyes. Autistic, yes, autistic, thank you. He can see with his eyes, retain what he sees, and then replicate it. Seeing with the eyes is not very unusual. Most people can see with their eyes, but most people cannot visualize. They can see with their eyes, but can they see in their minds and visualize what will eventually become the new reality? That is very powerful, being able to visualize things. Actually, a lot of professional teams have hired psychologists who help the players, for whatever sport, to visualize themselves playing against the opponent and seeing what they are going to do, how are they going to respond to the different challenges that the opposite team is bringing to the game or whatever. There was a study done about basketball. They brought two groups of people. One group that would be practicing for a given time free throws, and another group that will not throw free throws, but will think about themselves, imagine themselves throwing free throws. They did this exercise every day for a certain time, and then they brought both groups to the basketball court. The group that actually was practicing with a real basketball and the group that was imagining themselves throwing a basketball, and statistically, there was no difference. They made about the same amount of baskets. Visualizing is extremely powerful. We see that, for instance, in the case of David. When David was in front of Goliath, the giant, right? Remember? He told Goliath what he was going to do. I'm going to cut your head off. Today, you're going to fall down. I'm going to beat you. And this is how things are going to go. Before it happened. And guess what ended up happening? Exactly what he said was going to happen. He was capable of seeing not just with his eyes, but with his mind, visualizing and executing by faith. This pattern we also see in the case of Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 2 tells us about how Nehemiah proceeded to convince the people of Israel to build the wall of Jerusalem. Just so that you can get your memory a little refreshed, let me tell you, we find in the book of Nehemiah what the background. We find Israel was taken to captivity. Remember that? They were in Babylon, taken by Nebuchadnezzar. And you read about that in the book of Daniel. They were there for 70 years, and that was prophesied by Jeremiah. After the 70 years, the government that controlled the world changed hands. It was no longer the Babylonians, but the Medo-Persians. And the king of Persia gave authorization to the Israelites to go back to Israel. And they did, in effect. About 50,000 returned. While they went back, they felt that what they needed to do was to rebuild the temple. And they made the foundations, and you read about that in the book of Ezra, of the temple. The problem was that then they refocused on themselves and forgot the temple. They had to live in Israel. So they thought, let's build houses for us. And they built houses, and they built families, and they built businesses, but forgot the temple. Remember, the reason why they were taken as captives to Babylon to begin with was their sins. In order for them to restore their relationship with God, they thought we had to rebuild the temple. And guess what happened? They forgot about it. They came back, rebuilt their lives. Then, in the book of Ezra, we read about two prophets who come into the picture. prophet Zechariah and the prophet Haggai. And what they do is to encourage the people of Israel to go back and rebuild the temple. While they were living in palaces and nice-looking homes, the temple was still not being rebuilt. And so they began a movement of reconstruction. You read about that in the book of Haggai and the book of Zechariah, specifically the book of Haggai. And they rebuilt the temple, but guess what happened? The walls, they were not rebuilt. You remember how when Nehemiah, who is in the palace serving the king, hears about what's going on in Israel. The news he got were terrible. Rubbish. The place is destroyed. The wall is on the ground. It's burnt up. A place with no wall is like a country with no border. What is that? It's not a country. A place with no walls is like a house with no walls. What protection does the house have? Well, none. A wall was very important, was fundamental for a city in the ancient world. And so, Nehemiah, when he heard the walls were still in the ground, there was something that he felt needed to be done. And that's where we pick up our passage. In Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 9. So I went to the governors of Trans-Euphrates and gave them the king's letters. By the way, he got permission to go back. We talked about it last week. Go back. He got permission. He got resources. And now he's not just traveling, but making it to Israel. The king had also sent army officers and cavalry with me. Next. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite officials heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Isn't that something? It's like they're moving forward and these people are mad. It's like the famous saying, misery loves company. They want Israel to be miserable. Next. I went to Jerusalem. You can see that Nehemiah wrote the book of Nehemiah because this is all in first person. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except one I was riding on. By night, went out through the valley gate toward the jackal well and the dog gate. Examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which have been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on toward the foundation gate and the king's pool. Oh, I look like a pool. We shall get there. There's all kind of crazy stuff happening right now. All right, I'm going to move to the Bible. Verse 14. Then I moved on toward the fountain's gate and in the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. 15, so I went up to the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Verse 17. Are we back? Maybe? 17. Okay. Then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in? Jerusalem lies in ruin. Oh, there we go. And its gates have been burnt with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace. I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. They replied, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work. But when the Sanballat, the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite officials had, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked us and ridiculed us. "What is this you are doing?" they asked. "Are you rebelling against the king?" I answered them by saying, "The God of heaven will give us success." Amen. Few things that we can notice in our passage for today is obviously the fact that Nehemiah had his eyes open. He had open eyes to recognize his reality. He heard, but after coming, he saw. And then he personally knew the state of what's happening. He heard that the walls were destroyed. They were on the ground and the gates were burned and so on and so forth. But now he sees with his own eyes the reality. And the reality was something that he was also able to embrace. As we read in verse 17 once again where he says, "You see the trouble we're in. Jerusalem lies in ruin, and its gates have been burned with fire." He didn't hide. He didn't put a band-aid to the situation. He saw it, he owned it, he embraced it. This is where we're at. I believe that in the same way, we are to recognize where we are at. One of the most difficult things for anyone is to be honest with themselves. With the self. Are you able to take a dose of reality about yourself? Or the truth seems offensive to you? Oh, they are very sensitive subject that when you are faced with them, you get offended. Does that happen to you? Or are you capable of owning your reality? This is the fact. I was talking to somebody last week and I said, "I want you to tell me the blunt, the absolute real, the truth. Like, don't sugarcoat it. Tell me." And I was told. But I had to clarify what I wanted to hear. Because sometimes very polite people tell the truth in such a way that I don't get it. It's like, "Am I ugly?" Well, you are very unique. And in the way you dress, you're very particular. It's like, it almost sounds like a compliment, right? But what they're telling me is not a compliment. Like, I just want the truth. What is the naked, the real, the blunt truth? Jerusalem lies in ruins. And its gates have been burnt with fire. You know what is interesting is that this is redundant. It is redundant because he was talking to the people that lived there. They knew that. But this is the state of affairs. This is what we know. We have lived accustomed to no walls. Some people become comfortable in their mediocrity. And Nehemiah then came and said, "You don't have to be mediocre. This is the fact. It lies in ruins." This was actually an insult from Nehemiah. They needed someone who was not even born in Israel. Nehemiah was not born in Israel. He was born in captivity. The time frame doesn't match that he was born there. He was born in captivity, and they needed someone who was not born there to come there to fix things because those living in it did not see reality. This is what Jesus does. The naked truth is not nice, and most people don't like it. Oh, you Pharisees, hypocrite! And the scribes, the experts of the law, when they heard Jesus saying that, they said, oh, teacher, you're also offending us. And Jesus said, and you hypocrites, because they ignore the naked truth. They were hypocrites. They knew it, but didn't want to accept it. Once again, the example of an alcoholic. I think that's why Alcoholic Anonymous begin with, hello, I'm so-and-so, I'm an alcoholic. Because unless you recognize it, you can do nothing about it, right? You have to know it, you know? But there are very few people who actually are like that. because it's like I was talking to someone, are you alcoholic? No. Oh, you're not? No. Did you drink today? Yes. What about yesterday? Yes. And the day before? Yes. And the day before that? Yes. But you're not alcoholic? No. It's like, man. And what normally happens in my head is I ask this question. Are you hearing yourself? because if you can hear what I'm hearing, and I think I heard it right because I'm next to you and my hearing is okay, you're saying you're alcoholic, and yet you're denying it. What is the naked truth? Has God's plan be realized in your life? Or is it like the wall of Jerusalem that is collapsed and you've just grown accustomed to not working in God's plan in your life? It is obvious to me that Nehemiah knew what his plan was, what God's plan was for him. He knew that there was a need. He believed that with God's help, he could do something about it. And he embraced the reality, and he did something about it. He fulfilled God's plan for his life. As you can see, more likely, the only reason why God put Nehemiah in the palace was so that he would have access to the resources needed to go back and rebuild Israel. Probably so. But imagine, oh man, I'm in the palace. I got access to everything. I might die, but the food is good. Man, I might get poisoned, but the wine is amazing. Why would I go to a destroyed place if life is good? Well, because God wanted you there. are you fulfilling God's plan? Or are you like the people in Israel who are used to living in a collapsed, mediocre place? You have to have your eyes open to the reality. Recognize your reality. Number two, you have to have an open mind and visualize the possibility. In verse 17, we see once again Nehemiah. We are in trouble, but what? Next one. Come. Let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. And we will no longer be in disgrace. This is an insult, by the way. Oh, you disgraceful you. That's what he's saying. we no longer live in disgrace. He visualized the possibility. Visualizing is natural to people of faith. Because as Corinthians tells us, we live by faith, not by sight. We enable us to see beyond the physical. Actually, there is way more than what the physical can show us. This is always true. Even scientifically, for instance, scientists will tell us that this is mostly air. Believe it or not. They say that if you have a very, 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 very powerful microscope, you would be able to see atoms, and this mostly all empty space. You remember science class? That's what they will tell you. It's mostly empty space. Can you see it? No. I can see my finger, but there is way more than my eyes can see. If you put my finger in a very powerful microscope, you will see cells. And you'll see all kinds of movement happening in my finger. But my eyes can only see the finger. There is always more than what the eye can see, literally, scientifically. But this is also true spiritually. What the Bible tells us is that we are to be trained to see with the lenses of faith. Oh, the beautiful thing is that if you have eye problems, without the lenses, you don't see well. You put them on, and through the lenses, you see perfectly, right? In the same way, we are to put the lenses of faith to see and judge reality through them. What reality? The reality of what God can do. Amen. Or like the book of Hebrews tells us, seeing the invisible. Like, what in the world does that even mean? See what cannot be seen? Yes, because it's not there. But the power of God is of such kind that it can be there if you trust Him enough. But you have to see it. You know, I know God has a plan for your life. And you know probably by now that God has a plan for your life. One of the things I see in the Bible is that God doesn't waste anything. You know, you remember the fish and the bread, Jesus multiplied them and there were some left over. He threw them away and gave it to the dogs. Right? Wrong. Save them. Give them to the people. To other people. Amen? God doesn't waste anything. He doesn't waste talent neither. And so He made you and He has a plan for you. You're not alive just because, by the way. He has a plan for you. You need to build it up, though. Are the walls of God's plan in your life collapsed? Then you need to see them being built with the eyes of faith. You have to see and vision the possibility. I know you probably are in a specific place in your life, but is this where God designed you to be? Or is there more for you? Visualize the possibility of God's plan. Let the Holy Spirit move you. Oh, man, when the Spirit of God moves us, great things happen. But one thing I know, sometimes God makes things happen, period. But quite often He wants you to want to do it for Him. Let the Holy Spirit of God move you. And the movement is powerful. Now, Nehemiah was able to build because the people came on board. And I was meditating on our church and on the cross that is over there, and the people were praying for, serving, and preaching to. Oh, if we all were to actually do it. If we all to come on board in the same mind and actually do it, what would happen? If we go and make disciples, what would happen? How big will our church be? How many lives could we touch? If we build God's plan for our lives, what impact can we make in people's lives? You see the difference? Can you see it? But not with your eyes. You have to see it with the lenses and through the lenses of faith. Finally, active faith is what we see in Nehemiah. Verse 20, for instance, which would be the last verse. Let's see. I answer them by saying, you see, there's opposition. Every time you want to do God's will, there's opposition. And this is something that's a given. It should be expected. In the book of Ephesians chapter 6, the Bible says that our battle is not against flesh and blood, meaning we are in a fight. And you need to be mindful of that. Jesus also said, in the world you will find affliction. Things will cause affliction. People will oppose our movement forward. When we want to do God's will, Satan will bring maybe a person into your life that will stalk you because he wants you dragging, not moving forward. He wants you down. And this was the case with Nehemiah and the opposition he faced. I answer then by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. You sense any doubting here? The God of heaven maybe will give us success. Perhaps It's possible that he will give us. No. This is a man of faith speaking. He will give us success. And he spoke faith. Amen. And God honors that. Despite the enemy's opposition, we have a man who trusts. The enemies wanted him to stop building, but the faith says we need to keep on moving. But I also know that that's difficult to do, because where there is opposition, also fear comes in. What would people say? Would I lose my friends? What would happen to my resources? He will give us success. That's what will happen. I don't know how. But we will be successful because we're living in the will of God, fulfilling his plan. So, we see here then in Nehemiah a man who saw with his eyes. He had an open eye, an open mind to see with the eyes of faith, but he also had an active faith. As a result, he brought the people in and they were ready to build. You build because something is missing or because something is not finished. I want to show you a picture. I think we might have a picture at the end. One. If we don't, it's okay, but that's okay. No? No. Okay. I have no idea why the pictures are not there. That's weird. But last year there was a tornado in Florida. Ian. Remember Ian? Devastation was all over the place. I remember reading about one particular couple who, when they came back after, you know, they had to evacuate, and when they came back, the house was completely destroyed. And as soon as they got there, they were already making plans about rebuilding. They could move to somewhere else. I think that makes sense, actually. But they liked that place. They didn't want to just move. They wanted to rebuild. Rebuild. I think God is not done with you. God is not done with me neither. If God's plan is not fully fulfilled in our lives, we need to continue building. Understanding and embracing our reality, but envisioning what God will do and acting on faith. Amen. So we are builders. We are in the construction project. Let's keep it going. But if you haven't surrendered your heart to Jesus, there's a whole life that God designed for you that you have not made a reality. I invite you to come to Jesus. Right now is a perfect moment, and I'm going to stand right here. And if you want to give your heart to Jesus, if you haven't done that, if you haven't taken the step of faith, I invite you to come forward. Sign of repentance that you want to fully connect with Jesus. Pray. Catalina, welcome, by the way. I praise God for your decision today, which is the best decision in life you can make. It's a decision to follow Jesus. Father, I praise you for Catalina. Thank you for was your plan, and I know that you made her with a plan, and I praise you for Jesus who can make it a reality. Thank you for the Holy Spirit that touched her today, and thank you for what you're going to do in her by the power of Jesus. Thank you because forgiveness is possible and available in Jesus. Thank you because peace and joy is possible in Jesus. Says that the kingdom of heaven is for brave people, so I praise God for Catalina, who's brave enough to take this step of faith. And if you haven't yet, there is time. There is time. We all had to do this, by the way, because there is salvation in no one else but Jesus. So we invite you to come to Jesus, our Savior. Oh, Father. Father, we praise you and exalt you. We lift you on high, and we thank you for what we have learned from Nehemiah. The way that the passage is applicable to our lives is very powerful, and it only shows that this is a book that comes from you. Give us the courage to keep